nyosha mikono yangu juu na sifu nchi yangu marufu na nyosha mikono yangu juu na sifu nchi yangu marufu. Hello, hello Tanzania.
Actives, my partners, those here and those who are actually probably joining us on the live webcast, which we'll offer this morning again. That's the reason why each year, at the end of the year, we're trying to see if the smart partnership has such two different shapes, different meanings, while the same. So, and that's the reason why the Smart Partnership Movement's dialogues are so essential every year. And that's the reason why Smart Partnership dialogues are not, it's easy to say why they are not. They are not conferences, they are not this, they are not that. And it's difficult to those who come in new to understand what it is. And I don't think we can articulate very easily without a bit more kind of each year contribution towards the strategic framework of the Smart Partnership, different perspectives that where we come from. You have seen in this kind of agenda also a page which had what is called multiple perspective, which I haven't referred to because I thought we don't need to refer to many things, we just notice and probably one picks up the point. But I think it's worthwhile mentioning that about 10 years ago or so, the way smart partnership came about in an operative way, and then we realized what we are doing, was when particularly His Excellency President Museveni had a think tanking, first think tanking that he organized, he asked to be organized, and he wanted to press about the fact that people need to come freely and articulate their own way of cooperating with each other from their own where they come from. The language they speak, that's why we have Smart Partnership translated, Smart Partnership referred to in Swaziland, in how is it, Lomkosi? Kusheliana Ligwawa, right? Right. In Lesotho, what do we say? Mampai. Let's end. And so on and so on. Patria intelligente. So it's not a translation. It's actually what it does happen. And the way it's being expressed, this smart partnership, within different contexts. That's the reason why I was actually we are using Yaneer. Yaneer, you've never been coded to use so much here and all over. We are using Yaneer as a point of reference. Yesterday when we finished, I requested him to refer again to culture. And this is not a library as such. It's an inverted comma, a library of ideas and people. That's what we're saying. But then, anyway, here is what actually otherwise Bachiga says. But if you know that, we need to add it, if you publish anyone, what Bachiga says, that the system is.
Actually, she has compiled with him, right? You know, I had that for yesterday.
Yes. Actually, if you look into the Bachiga's collection that we have in the last, it's a treasure, in the last kind of 10 years.
Yeah?
It's a language of smart partnership in a Bachiga way.
Yes, every one of these statements
says
something about us.
Kind of,
say something, you can pick another one at random. Say,
mind you,
but those who cannot be here are also together with us.
Isn't that true?
They have not refused to come, but they are with us.
So, in other words, if you try to learn the Batigas language. It might be as complex as reading this book. But he translated to us, and I think it's like I already speak Batiga now, after 10 years.
We don't understand.
I speak systems, but let's listen what he says.
Yeah, but it's not a language.
Okay,
thank
you very much.
Daniel. So, I very much appreciate that introduction. I do think that there's a very deep sense in which traditional wisdom, not knowledge, but really wisdom, is about system, about how things depend on each other. And that we are beginning using science and complex systems to expose what that means to understand those things. So, what I'm going to do now is really just actually not talk about systems thinking in general, but about specifically the issue of economic development. I just remind you what we talked about yesterday, and we talked about that there is a lot of data in the world, and we don't want to just look at how one thing correlates with another, or alternative two other things correlate with each other. We really want to understand how things work across all the information that we can obtain about the system. And in some sense, it's like putting a puzzle together. This is an amusing picture of a field that was one time planted in New York City, basically. But the idea of the linkage between people and crops and urban environments and how everything works together is something that we want to understand. So we're trying to build this systems view. And in order to do this, we use data, which is really about the past, of course, to understand the dependencies that exist in the system. And that's what gives us the system. It's the dependencies, once we understand. And once we understand the dependencies, then we can talk about what is going to happen. And in particular, it's really about understanding cascades that occur through the system, crises, and leverage points. The key of leverage points is how do we decide what we want to do and make it happen. So when we have a complex dependent system, we all, I'm sure, have the experience of thinking that a certain action will have a certain effect, and it may have a completely different effect, may even have the opposite effect of what one intends. And so by understanding the dependencies, the patterns of behavior of the system, we can change that to really being figuring out what's the right place to push on the system in order to get what we want. And so I'm going to apply this now to development policy. So let me give you a little bit of the background of this. Yesterday I spoke briefly about our work on the food crisis. I mentioned a little bit about the financial crisis. We have a bunch of papers about the financial crisis, about dependencies among banks and the rest of the economy, about the European bond crisis. A lot of different parts of the financial crisis, which I didn't talk about yesterday. In the aftermath of doing that work, we spoke with part of the UN called the Common Fund for Commodities, and we discussed that we would develop an understanding of how commodity volatility, which is really what they care about, is impacting on development. Now, I don't know if anybody is not aware that the prices of commodities have gone down recently. That's something that we knew was going to happen. The question is understanding how this links to development in not a trivial way. And in order to do that, we have to develop a framework for understanding development, economic framework. And that's what I'm going to talk about now. So I'm going to explain where we are in this. And before I talk about it, let me just say what is the traditional economic framework for development. It's the, quote, Washington consensus, which a little bit caricatured is this, but not that much caricatured, actually, right? The idea is that if you make free markets and open borders, everything will work. There's no dynamics here. There's no, how do you get here, there, from here? The experience is not that good with this description. How do we develop our understanding? And I'm going to give you the end result here. I'm going to explain the structure and how I want to get there. The first point is that we really need to understand how financial flows work in the system. Where are the flows taking place? And I'll explain how that works. And we have to understand the positive and negative roles of boundaries. So open boundaries is not the only answer. Play an important role.
This document, are we going to be able to get this? We don't all
no.
be scribbling right
this is, you can scribble as much as you want, but I cannot give you this. It's not published yet. So you guys are privy to secret information right now. I'm not kidding you. We do not reveal information until it's published. Usually, this is a special occasion where we're sharing this. This is in the process of being written up. As soon as it's published, which will be within months, I will be happy to share it with you, but this is privileged information. And please respect it as such.
Yaneer, were we to add smart partnership here and there? Would we be part of that publishing? Because we're a sounding board.
More direct way. The reason why I'm discussing this, and this is really true, I wouldn't discuss it were it not that we have a very specific agenda.
Yeah.
I'd like to partner with you.
I want
to explain that. I'm going to get to that at the end. But there's a real now current opportunity for partnership in order to take this to the next step.
But it has to be a smart partnership.
Absolutely.
Anyway, let's
but there's a really specific reason that I would like to share this with you.
Yeah.
And otherwise I wouldn't, because it's not yet published. The third piece of this that I'm going to talk about is the role indeed of volatility in investment, which we all understand intuitively probably, but the formalization of that has not really been done. The final statement is that in order to be able to implement the policy, unlike the Washington consensus, we have to understand specific country needs. We cannot specify the policy until we do the analysis, and that's the next step. Okay, so we haven't done the realization of policy recommendations because we can't yet. We need the information. We'll talk about that. So I want to start this discussion from something very basic in economics. This is something that you will find in at the beginning of any economics textbook. It's also something that is eventually ignored in economics because they ignore the dynamics. But this is just how economic flows work. Firms pay wages to households. This is just a distortion of the translation that we have to do to get this on the screen here. And then there's spending. The important thing is that this is a cycle. Okay. These things don't separate. If you don't have one flow, you cannot have the other flow. This is a really crucial piece of information.
What about taxes?
What?
Taxes.
Taxes. This is only one piece of the picture, right? But this idea of cyclicity has to always be present. If money accumulates somewhere, the economy doesn't. Okay? taking it one step further, I'm not going to quite get to where you want to go, but here's, there are, we can separate labor and capital. That L is supposed to be up with a capita, so it's capital, right? And so there's spending and wages, and then there's investment and returns. And these are different kinds of financial flows, because one is a transfer and the other one is a transfer of ownership, which is different, okay? So we have to understand this structure. What I want to do is take this one step further, and this is the framework that I'm going to talk about, okay? This is the economic framework. It's not exactly what we will use in application, so your question is relevant here because we want to understand more flows like taxation. But I just want to illustrate the ideas, okay? So this is about separating the economy into three different sectors, just for simplicity. There's an agricultural sector, there's an extractive sector, and there's a manufacturing and service sector, okay? Each of these sectors has flows associated with capital and wages and purchases, okay? So it's just more lines representing what we had before, because now I have three different sectors. There's also transfers of payments for between the sectors. There's also exports and imports. So this outer boundary represents the outside world. And so we have flows. This is a financial flow of products being exported, resulting in financial flows going into the system. This is a purchases that are resulting in inflow of products from the outside. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Ask questions now. If you have questions about how I'm doing this, ask it now, because this is the crux of what I'm working
on. So, Yaneer, the financial services, which is massive, it accounts for more than manufacturing in many countries. Where do you categorize that?
We can ask, we can in principle include them in services, or we could separate them out. But one of the key things is the investment. And this is the investment flow. So here you have capital. Here you have investment flows. And the point of this is to go back again to a simple view of an economy as formed out of these three sectors. And to the extent that we need to represent other kinds of flows, that's what we would do if we want to understand a particular system. Right now, I'm trying to illustrate the ideas using this kind of structure.
May I also ask, I mean, when you say the conventional productivity function, then there is a residual called technology, which is not, there's no residual here.
We don't have to represent technology. What we are representing is just the economic
money,
flows themselves.
Money flows.
That's right.
Money.
That's right. It's a question of what we're choosing to represent, and this is what we're choosing to represent.
Money.
It's an important question. Yes.
Must all the three be integrated, or can you survive with agriculture?
You know, what I'm doing here, and this is exactly the right question. This is a framework that I'm now going to ask: how does a particular country behave?
Yeah.
Okay. And so this question about what happens if you have just agriculture, or if you have just extractive industries, oil industries, or mine, other forms of mining. This is exactly what we're going to do next. Yeah.
Phil, how does intellectual capital and value flow around your system there?
Intellectual capital is something that modifies the nodes of this system, but it influences the behavior of the dynamics, but is not represented. What I'll show you is there's a specific kind of question that we're trying to ask here. The specific kind of question has to do with the structure of the transaction system. I accept the question. It's a very important question.
I think what we wanted to say from this, we are referring to intellectual equity in smart partnerships. We're saying
When I take one more step forward, you'll see what I'm after.
Okay.
Yeah.
For purposes of this discussion, is this...
What I want to be clear is what it is that I am representing. The fact that I'm not representing everything about society is appropriate. It has to do with one of the questions that I'm going to ask.
Yeah.
And we'll see that in a minute. Yes.
Yeah, for purposes of this discussion, are we to think of this as an open system or a closed system?
Okay. Open and closed are often a confused issue. This is an open system because there's an outside world to which it is coupled. In this case, frame of reference, we're thinking about this as a country coupled to the global economy through the financial flows to the boundary. What is more subtle, the key thing, remember, that I'm trying to capture here is the role of cyclicity. Okay, everything that modifies parts of the system that don't engage the cyclicity, I don't need to include in the picture. That's why I'm not including intellectual capital, I'm not including technology, because that's not actually affecting the cyclicity. Yes? Yes?
Why households and not labor and not people?
Very good question. The point is the following. If I just said labor and capital,
say people. Then.
People. You can call it
instead
people.
Instead of households.
You can call it people if you want.
We do need to know where he's getting that.
Yeah.
Please.
I'll go on in a moment, but we're just talking about people. There is an important issue here, which is that in principle, in many societies, labor and capital are separate, right? There's a group of people that are labor, a group of people that are capital. But that's not fundamental. So the model allows for both to be incorporated in the same individuals, okay? All right. So let me now take examples of economic systems. The first one is a subsistence agriculture. Subsistence agriculture doesn't involve financial flows, so all I'm doing is representing it here as separate, really, from what we talked about. What I want to do is to... Let's look at what happens if we have an economy that's dominated by an extractive industry. And this is often the case in developing countries or in countries today. What's happening here is we have the extractive industry and we have a financial flow into this arising from the exports. What happens to the money once it comes into the system? It goes out. Okay? Here is going out in the case of where capital that owns the industry is something that is, the owners are outside the system, right? They're foreign owners. So we have capital flow going back out. There's reinvestment, which is a small flow. There is a small amount of labor expense in the country. This labor is then going out of the country due to what? Due to the fact that there is very little manufacturing and services in the country.
The import.
So this is the imports. Now, the key thing about this structure is notice that there is no cycles in the country. In fact, the internal economy is very weakly coupled to anything that's going on. Does this sound familiar?
Yes, it
does. Okay. So notice that this representation captures directly this issue of the fact that an extractive industry that is basically coupled to the global economy but has very little to do with the domestic economy really doesn't give rise to development in the way we would think about it. Is that clear? Now we might have a slight modif- so this is the money coming in goes out of the system. That's the primary flow.
Would there be some rental income coming into the country as a result?
So if the ownership is inside the country, that's represented here. If the ownership is inside the country, then the flows will come in, but again, the capital will go out for investment in foreign markets. And again, is even though it came in to the country, it doesn't stay. It flows out.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Can you elaborate in the case of multinational companies?
In what?
Multinational companies.
Well,
use the cheap labor in most of the developing countries.
Mm-hmm. So the point is that when the cheap labor, the payment for labor is happening, the question is, where does the flow go from there? And the answer is, if most of it goes to imports, then the flow goes out of the country. So what we see is that in this case, notice that the flows come in and go out, and don't cycle within the country. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Does this make sense? You know it well, exactly. So now if I had an agriculturally based economy, which was a cash crop economy, we would have a very similar picture, only going through agriculture. So I've illustrated here the case where ownership is in the country. It might also be, we could illustrate the case of ownership outside the country. But again, the cash flows in to get the product, which is the cash crop. But then it goes through investment out of the country. The labor that goes in is also going out. So again, we have flows that go in and out of the country. What do we want? Okay, so let's look at what an emerging economy looks like. So in an emerging economy, we have imports, exports that are giving rise to cash flow in, but inside the country there's labor that is buying and there is capital that is being reinvested in the country. So notice that the flows are cycles inside the country. Is that clear? Why? Because if we have cyclical flows inside the country, this is the mechanism by which economic progress takes place. Why improvements in welfare are happening. Now, when we have flows through the global economy, it is a global economy cycle, but it doesn't create diversified economic activity within the country. Is that clear? You know it well, right? This is not surprising. But the point is that this is the way to capture it in this representation. So what do we need? We need closed loops of production and consumption within the country that consists of both investment flows and purchases, right? So investment and purchases of domestic products and coupled to them wages and returns from domestic products. Is that clear?
Yes.
And this is what gives rise not just to economic activity, but diversified economic activity. So let's go back to the standard policy advice. The standard policy advice is free markets and open borders, which is coupling the country economy, the global economy, for those very, very few things that the country can compete in the global economy. Is that clear? But if other products of the domestic economy are going to be overwhelmed by the imports, within the context of the strong global economy that is producing those goods. Now, which is good? And the answer is, well, we need both, but they need to be somehow balanced in the right way. So instead of having this kind of economy where things flow out, we really want to have... So the point is that this is the natural outcome. It's the direct result, like a mathematical theorem, you created these policies, you ended up with this result. So if you see this a lot, it shouldn't be surprising, because this is what we asked for. By creating the policies that are being advocated. Isn't that clear? Okay, does that want to make sense?
Yes. Excuse me?
Yeah.
Would that picture change if you were to have local investors in the
Well, again, the reason why people invest is because they'll get the highest returns. And it's not enough to have just investment, you have to have investment in purchases and manufacturing, you have to have the whole cycle. So you have to create all of the pieces of the cycle. This is it. Remember, we have to have all of these pieces in order to make it work. So you're saying, what if we had this, or this one, we have this one? And the answer is, well, we need that one, and the investment has to be returned, and we need to have this. So if you say, I'm gonna add one piece, well, that doesn't necessarily solve the problem. Okay, and this is why development doesn't work, because you stick one part of the picture in place, and you don't have all the rest of the parts. And even if you put in one part and the other parts, they have to work together in order for it to be functional. It's like, you can't stick your heart in and your liver in and expect everything to work. You know? Okay. Yeah.
Thank you. I just want to know to what extent is this related to standards, especially when it comes to trade, because I see this applicable to the case of Botswana beef industry. There is an arrangement with the EU that a certain percentage of the beef that we export to the EU should be consumed within the country, because their concern is that if we maintain certain standards for exports and other standards for local consumption, then the substandards may
I can't answer right now specific policy questions because we haven't done an analysis.
Okay.
But maybe we should. Let me keep going for just a little bit, all right?
There is one remark here.
Let me go on just a little bit, and then I'll...
I can proceed.
Go ahead, ask the question.
No, but it was just, Ted, you can't go ahead, it's fine.
Go ahead.
It was just but one point that I think, I don't know if you touched that, but in my view, particularly in the context of the type of country that you were mentioning, it would be essential to consider. And it is the role of the loops that you have with natural resources.
Absolutely.
And also environmental
Absolutely.
Impact and protection,
Environment.
Because that part, if you are depleting the natural
Absolutely.
Capital,
yes.
then that's an essential factor to take into consideration
Absolutely.
Of the dynamics
Absolutely.
Of the system.
Okay, so now let me talk about two different pieces of strategy about policies, okay? So the first one is about the boundaries. So what is the purpose of boundaries? The purpose of boundaries is to protect domestic economic cycles, right? Enable developing new domestic cycles, right? So this is about the protection and balancing the links to the global economy with the internal dynamics. So we want the external links, but we want also the internal. And the classic method in economics for doing this is exchange rates, right? Exchange rates don't always work for important reasons. So let's talk about that for a moment. So this is the model of exchange rates that works in an, I quote, ideal world. What you do is you have a set of possible exchange rates. So this is the value of the exchange rate. I've indicated one possible value here in red. And what you have is that if you move the exchange rate up in the way I've defined this, then you would end up with unemployment because you have high cost of domestic labor. If you move it down, then you end up with employment because you have lower cost of domestic labor relative to the global labor market, and you have increasing GDP because of that production. But let me show you how this relates to this issue of extractive economy dominance, right, the commodity-dependent countries. If you have this, then and these two things, these two pieces are in some sense separated. The labor and production costs and value of these two things are different. And so what we have is we have a readily available commodity, which has not yet been depleted, which if it couples to the global economy, the labor rates are worth paying. Okay? But we have another economy down here that would be producing all kinds of other things that would require a very different exchange rate. You understand? So there is there's like two different economies.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
With different effective labor rates. And so you cannot have the exchange rate in both places. What we would like to do, therefore, is to have some kind of heterogeneous policy. You can imagine separating the extractive industry from the rest of the economy and having a different exchange rate for each. It's not clear that that's practical. But in some sense, having different kinds of policies that are more elaborate than just having a single exchange rate is really what this is all about. Is that clear? And many countries do that, right? For, you know, different countries that are managing the export-import balance set up policies that are relevant for different parts of the economy. Is that clear?
Yaneer, but would that relate, let's say, to someone who's digging the product out of the ground and exporting it raw, but running,
value addition.
When you add value to the commodity.
Right.
So you're
exactly right. That's the next thing, so thank you. That was perfect. Let me just say something about this. The point is that it may not be enough. There are economies where costs, inherent costs, this is one of the understandings of why development doesn't take place in many places, is because in effect, the exchange rate that would have to happen is effectively negative, right? Because the existing costs make labor rates that would be competing with the global economy effectively negative, right? I don't know if that's clear why that's the case, right? Because there are costs associated with that. All right. So the point is that how do we deal with this situation? At this point, I have to say, well, we have to analyze what's going on in order to figure out which policies are correct. It's not that I can give a standard policy.
Yes.
So this is now going to your point about value added and stuff. So what we want to do is we want to have, in some sense, we recognize that there are two different kinds of economic activity. And what we want to do now is to leverage this economic activity in order to create more of this kind of economic activity. Is that clear? Yes.
I just have a problem with the graphs on the previous slides.
Yes.
Why the GDP is not changing with time?
Why the GDP is not what?
Changing with time in the red line.
This is what this snapshot is doing is showing how GDP depends on exchange rate.
At a particular moment.
At a particular moment. I'm not incorporating the dynamics here. But what it's trying to do is illustrate the exchange rate sensitivity to the GDP. Right? Is that clear? As you did, right. Okay,
the absolute number of GDP, not the trend.
Correct.
The absolute number.
Absolutely. Well, right, at a particular point in time. Right. So that's correct. So if we have these two economies, we can ask, what do we have to do in order to use one for the other?
Yes, there's a little bit of, I want to ask some clearer. You said GDP depends on the exchange rate.
Yeah.
Are you talking about UNP or GDP? Because the GDP is, you know, referred to domestic production.
Yeah.
Then the GNP is domestic production plus external inflow.
So both of them will depend upon the exchange rate.
Yeah.
So you can plot both of them.
How does GDP depend on exchange rate? Because GDP is the total value of things produced within the economy.
Correct, but it includes also the things that are created that are then exported. Correct? Yeah.
That's the meaning of things.
The point is just the following. that when you change the labor rates of the country relative to the global economy, you will change the economic activity. That's the only point.
Okay, so if you are taking into consideration the export value, it's okay.
Yeah, it's the other part of this is...
But in an economy which is autonomous, for example, the case of the United States...
The economy that's autonomous, exports don't matter. Exchange rates don't matter at all.
Okay, that's what I wanted to say.
Yeah,
okay,
absolutely.
Okay.
I think we are trying to say that... He's only, Yaneer is only bringing this up, not literally to include it into the limitless opportunity, the manifesto, but probably as a question that he has.
No. Let me
but
explain.
You have about 10 minutes.
Yes. You know me, I don't have limitless time.
Yeah.
Yes.
We do.
We
have.
Part of the movement.
For
us,
we have.
So, the point is that if we want to use the coupling to the global economy through the commodity exports to promote the domestic economic activity, we want to promote investment and diversified economic activity. Here's the key issue is the risks associated with the global economic activity. Okay. And so I want to point out what we did yesterday, which is we talked about the volatility of food prices. We talked a little bit about the volatility of energy prices, which now are again, you know, showing their volatility. And just to point out the fundamental role of volatility in social systems. So this is, you know, if we have this all the time, then we're fine. If we have this all the time, then people are not there, right? If we have fluctuations between them, then things don't work, okay? Because we try to adapt to this, and then that happens. That doesn't work. So the same thing applies when we have commodity volatility or volatility in general in the economic activity. So the point is that if the global commodity price volatility is high, that will cause similar problems in leveraging that for development. So in general, right, this is an under-diversified economy. Undiversified economy has volatility risks, and that leads to problems with investment, okay? So we need to figure out how to stabilize this. Now, this is just a statement about the need to figure out the economic investment impacts of volatility. And there are various ways. This is, you know, there are discussions of how volatility impacts on value of investment and how much one should invest. What I put down here at the bottom is that the traditional theoretical frameworks also do not include non-extreme events, right? They do not include not normal distributions. And we really need to include them in order to understand what's going on. All right, this I've really said. So the policy advice here is the following. So let me go back. There are two different statements about policy that I want to make. Number one is that boundaries are important, and we have to tune the role of boundaries in order to enable development. The second is that we really need to quantify the risks associated with volatility, because by quantifying it, we also bound it. And when you don't know the extent of the risks, then they appear much even larger than they are. So this is something that we need to do. So here's the next step. What I've tried to do today is I've talked about kind of a generic framework in which we can understand the problems and opportunities of development. What we need to do is to build instantiated models of particular countries that enable us to understand what policy should be present. This is what we plan to do next, but we've not done. Now, here's the last statement. We actually have the opportunity to do this. We don't have enough funding to do this for everybody, but we have enough funding to do this for one country, basically. But just to give you a sense, the
to pay for the postdocs and students, just our expenses, is several hundred thousand dollars, let's say $500,000 of expenses to build the models, to analyze them in terms of policy implications, and to come up with specific policy recommendations. We currently have, we received an unrestricted grant that allows us to do this for one country, basically. So if anybody is available for collaborating on this, we need data. So we need financial flow data that presumably would be available to domestic banks. And if we can get that data, we can construct this model quantitatively and determine policy recommendations. So I think that's really where we are. I spoke about the recommendations in terms of complex systems. We need to know the financial flows. We need to understand the role of boundaries. We need to understand the role of volatility and uncertainty, and to do it for particular countries. And that's the presentation. Yes.
Can you do it based on the current definition of GDP, or do you have to?
GDP is not the variable we're going to look at. GDP is something that we can calculate from the model, but the model is going to represent the actual financial flow. So it's, this is the point, that the traditional thinking starts from a couple of measures, GDP and unemployment. And that doesn't give you the right kinds of information to figure out what you're doing.
Coming back also to the previous statement, I'm thinking that if you're reasoning on policy and funds in these analyses, which I think is extremely interesting and valid, I would dedicate part of it also to the analysis related to the natural capital and the social impacts. Because if you take into account only this economic landscape, the impact could be disruptive in negative terms. And this is what's happening, for example,
if you
take a lot of particularly African countries today and with certain things. So that is absolutely critical. You cannot forget the link with the natural capital and the social impact, which can be analyzed exactly with the same approach, but need to be linked in the dynamics. Yeah.
Thank
but,
you very much.
But the sometime in 1970s, early 70s, the limits to growth, the modeling that was used at that time, has been used at that time, were concerned with similar things. Of course, what you portray now and what you're proposing is based on a number of things that took place, like financial crisis in particular, but also in relation to complex system development. So it's in fact an application that you're trying to do to a kind of today type of understanding of how global economics might work
in
relation
not
in relation to only an African country, because that is where is the problem, which I didn't see. Is in relation to any country,
right?
That is a developed country or any other country.
In principle, this can be a model of global economic development.
That is the value of it.
Does the concept of resistance levels have a place in this analysis?
Resistance levels?
Yeah, when you talk about food, you know, their resistance levels in stock market flows, for instance, that it didn't prices. So can that be built on the...
It can be represented in the system. The question that's always critical is, we can ask it, the question is it going to be relevant to the question that we're asking? But in principle, we can.
Could I just ask, whilst your models are looking at natural flows or country flows, a lot of the people in this room have been trying to relate to regional activity, because shared standards bodies, shared facilities and laboratories going into one country doing work in another country. So
it's really only a question
of the
what data we have,
yeah,
so that we can analyze the structure of the system.
Yeah.
Sorry, that was exactly my question. Could it be applied to our
regional
single market, for instance?
Absolutely. Any other questions? Because I think I think I'm going to get the hook pretty soon. Yes.
Yeah, you are now concentrating on commodities.
No.
As after the financial stock market has crashed, and you are trying to bring in the GDP in relation to exchange rate and commodity prices. Is it a move from the financial stock market phantom wealth to attack the commodity prices and create more speculation there, so that there is more destabilization of production on the ground?
So there are policy issues that you're raising that we've been raising for the last, you know, 6 years or so. And they have to do with the statement that the policy about how markets are being structured is affecting detrimentally the dynamics of the global commodity system. This is something that we are pushing on, but that's a global policy. It's US policy, European policy. Here, what we're doing is we're trying to say, whatever the outside system is doing, what are the country policies that will enable effective survival and thriving in the existing circumstances?
So, were we to take South Africa, Malcolm, what do you feel about it? We have data. The reason why I suggested is because we're having smart partnership dialogue in South Africa and all that. There is plenty of data. It depends what data they require.
Right. Well, we need financial flow data, transaction data. And it's not enough to have GDP. And
they're not typical data. But what do you feel? What do you feel the concept?
No, not to answer your question directly, but I was going to ask in terms of the balancing and the boundaries.
Yes.
Aren't the options or the policy options skewed by the rules of the game at the international level? Through WTO, the EFTA,
absolutely. The point is that once one understands the direction that one needs to go, then one has to navigate the geopolitical context.
Yeah.
But at least you have an understanding of what you need to do in order to achieve the outcomes that you want.
Sure.
What do you, because you have a different set of rules for different countries, so like the United States can have a massive debt load and no one really cares. I mean, people are still investing in the U.S. stock market
again,
around the world.
What I'm doing is I'm analyzing from the point of view of a particular country, in this country. Analyzing the global system, we have projects with
each country will have a different set of rules that will be applied by the global system.
Right. And so what we need eventually is a global strategy that enables all parties to develop. And that's the win-win smart partnership approach, which this kind of analysis enables us to go around.
Which for you?
Not this kind of analysis. This analysis enables us to go around. Okay? Other questions? I don't know whether I'm getting a hook yet, but if you have other questions, I'm happy to talk with anybody who wants to discuss the practical details. Again, the practical details have to do with
that
arranging.
How practical is this?
Yeah.
I was asking how practical is this in the globalizing world?
As soon as we have the access to the data, it will be about 6 months before we have preliminary results. And about 2 years before the effort will be complete.
And then you will discover what?
We'll discover what are the directions of policy interventions that are needed in order to promote domestic growth.
Because
my question is whether you anticipate what you discover to be whatever.
Well,
it's a workability of what you discover.
But every country is like a boat on a sea.
Right.
They all have different shapes.
It's not a zero-sum game.
I know. They all have different shapes, and they're all bobbing on a sea when everybody else is. Some of them are underwater shooting at you, but that's another story.
That's right.
But they all have different structures. Now, if you try, as you say, you can't impose the same rules on
them. No, but that's exactly the point. That's why I can't tell you what to do before I look at the
You're going to select one of those boats, as it were. Exactly.
We have to start somewhere. No, we're not going to extrapolate.
Yeah.
We're going to then be able to get data for other places.
Okay.
We're not
see how this
exactly.
To
make the entire framework, we have to have all the data. But in the meantime, we have to start somewhere. You had a question.
Yes, you ended with a very good sentence. Not one size fits all.
Yes.
Is this, as somebody has asked, applicable across?
It's applicable. The framework is applicable to everybody, but the results depend upon what we obtain when we do the analysis. Because here, I'm just saying, you know, this is kind of what an economy looks like, but each economy is different. So we have to be able to put in the numbers and say what's going on in a particular economy in order to figure out what interventions.
So you can't take the results from one economy.
No. That's the whole point.
Could I not necessarily?
So what I'm going to talk about has to do with the fact that the world is connected. Things are dependent on each other, and we see that in crises, right? The financial crisis, pandemic, like Ebola, global terrorism. This slide, so this is about the financial crisis. We're missing pieces of it, I don't know why. This is Tahrir Square, which you may remember during the Arab Spring. This is the recent Ebola and current, still going on Ebola problems. I use this slide for audience. Do you recognize this? This is from The Matrix.
Yes.
Yeah. So this is about the world as data, if you think about it. These are number streams that are flowing down that are representing things that are happening in the world. And what I wanted to do is to point out that in traditional statistics, if you were to study this, you would take two of these number streams and you would correlate them with each other. And if you were taking, you wanted to do something else, you would take two other number streams and correlate them with each other. But in complex systems, we can take the entire set of data and study patterns in the data. And it really enables us to do different kinds of things, answer different kinds of questions. Now, me at my institute, we've done many different domains of inquiry, lots of different things, for education, cell biology, development, economic development, ethnic violence. And it's surprising that we would be able to do all these different things, but the reason is because we really have these different tools. Multi-scale representations, I'll talk about networks a bit, and patterns. So here's a little bit about multi-scale stuff. This is a photograph of mountains in a valley. If you look closely, you see that the image is made out of pixels, right? Little square regions that have color in them. Now we know that we can, if we reduce the resolution, if we eliminate detail, we can use less memory on the computer to show this. So I'm just showing you this here. This is higher resolution, lower resolution, lower resolution, lower resolution. You see that? Eventually, we get to this. Now this is, in some sense, still the mountain and the valley. We've lost the details that we care about. So what we have to do is to understand this, and there's a tool that we use for doing this. It's called the complexity profile. It's the amount of information as a function of the resolution. So as we reduce the detail, we end up with less and less information, and that's what this picture shows. So this is all the details, and this is kind of the biggest stuff that's going on, which is typically the motion of the system. And from a policy perspective, and this is what I'm going to focus on today, what we really want to do is understand the biggest stuff. So what's going to affect the whole system? And that's kind of the thing that policy, first of all, has to understand. And so this is what I was a little bit talking about before. If we are completely independent, we can do statistics. If we're completely dependent things, then we can do dynamics in a simple way. If we have this flock of birds, well, they're not moving all together. It's not a good description. And we don't want to talk about what each of the birds is doing. We have to describe the collective behavior of the system, the patterns that are going on. And that's really where complex systems is needed, and the tools are effective. So I'm going to talk a little bit about extreme events, because in recent years we've been spending a lot of time dealing with crises, using the science, and the world has been dealing with crises a lot. So how do extreme events happen? And this goes back to the normal distribution. And I want to compare this normal distribution with a fat tail distribution. And the key idea is, if we look over here at events that are sort of big events, extreme events, they're much more likely in this fat tail distribution than in the normal distribution or thin tail distribution. So the key idea is that if you look at normal distribution, if you look at 100 events, you've basically seen them all. But if you look at a fat tail distribution, you could be surprised the next day, because an extreme event will happen. So if this is kind of a normal event, the way normal events happen is their combination, that's a kind of extreme event which wouldn't happen in the normal distribution. So a normal event will happen because we'll take little pieces and we'll add them together, but the little pieces are happening randomly, so they're independent, and that gives you normal distribution. There might be another couple here, yeah. They're just sort of going in any direction. Whereas with the extreme event, the way they happen is by things working together. You might have a few that are going in the other direction, but if they add up to create the big event, that's because they're dependent on each other. So dependencies and extreme events go hand in hand. Is that clear? All right, good. So let's talk about what people do together, because when people do things together, if they do things all at once, then you end up extreme events in social systems. Let's talk about Terrier Square for a moment. Why did this happen? So most sources, if you ask this question, they will say, well, there were these dictators. Okay? But they were around for a long time. So it's really kind of hard to attribute the events to that. Here's a better answer. This is a plot, this black line, is a food price index put out by the UN, the FAO, the Food and Agricultural Organization that puts this out. These red dashed lines are the dates of food riots, and these are the dates of the Arab Spring. See that? The blue dashed line over here is the date we submitted a report to the US government saying high food prices, social unrest, political instability. That was 4 days before Mohamed Bouazizi started things in Tunisia. Okay, so we get some credit for anticipation. Now, to say that food prices are connected to riots shouldn't be surprising. I don't think that this work is innovative in doing that. But there are a couple of things that this study shows that are really important. First of all, these are global food prices. And these are local riots and revolutions around the world. That's really important. That wouldn't have been true 50 years ago. Maybe even 30 years ago. The other thing is that this seems to indicate that at about 210 on this index, there's a kind of threshold where a lot of places, a lot of countries begin to have riots and revolutions. That's important. All right, now this is the global food supply system, if you will. This is the food exporters and importers, exporters in blue and importers in red, of wheat. I could show you for corn and for rice. We could look at this in more detail. And we have done some of that, but not enough yet. But the point is that this is a global system of food supply. Okay. What did we lose here? Oh, yes. So what I want to do, so I want to look, if you look up here, that's supposed to be a video of this food prices. Do you see this food prices here? This small image shows the food price from 1990. And what you see is that the food prices are going up and down, and then in recent years they shoot up. You see that? So this really requires an explanation. This is not the expected behavior of food prices. Why did this happen? So there are lots of explanations that have been given in the literature. I'm going to take four of them, and they're not the reasons. Okay? I'll just tell you what they are. One is in changing meat consumption in China, right? China developed, there are more meat eaters there. Could that be important? The answer is no, it's not big enough, actually. There were droughts in Australia, not important enough. Exchange rates, and that turns out in this oil prices leading to food prices increase. That also is not important. The only thing that turns out to be important is one, taking corn in the United States and sticking it into gasoline engines, into cars. 45% of US corn is being put into gasoline. That's enough to feed, it's a food value that would feed 2/3 of a billion people. That's important. The other problem is speculation on commodity markets. This is financial speculation that creates bubbles and crashes. So we put these together into a quantitative model of prices. And this is what we get. So the blue line is the data now. The red dash dotted line is the mathematical model. How did we do? Remarkably well. Now, what this shows, it tells us how things are constructed. The dashed line here is the effect of corn to ethanol conversion. Okay, so we know that the corn to ethanol conversion is responsible for a doubling. This starts here at about 100 and goes up to about 200 here. It's responsible for a doubling of food prices. Now, in case you're not aware of it, this is a US government mandate. The US government passed a law about how much ethanol should be made, and it's being taken from corn. And so this is a mandate by the US government to create biofuels, which are causing a doubling of food prices. Quite remarkable. The other thing is the speculation. Here is a point. For all the economists in the room, sorry, what you've learned in economics is equilibrium economics. It doesn't do dynamics. And therefore, there's no paper in the economics literature that studies quantitatively the dynamics of bubbles and crashes. But we did do it because we're not limited by the assumptions of economics. And we are able to reproduce these bubbles. Now, these bubbles are out of equilibrium. Can I ask a question?
Yes. How much of the effect is the speculation and how much is the ethanol?
So this dashed line would be the result without the speculation. That's the ethanol.
But with the ethanol?
With the ethanol, without the speculation. And the difference between this and this, the red line, is the effect of the speculation. So when you ask how much, it's not a fixed percentage over time because it's dynamic. So here, the speculation is causing a doubling of food prices. By this date, which is now, the ethanol by itself is causing a doubling of food prices.
Is the size of the ethanol, how much the ethanol affects the market, similar to, say, China and the meat?
China is an order of magnitude smaller.
Okay, so that's not enough to do.
That's the point. So if you look at the amount of the impact of ethanol on grain, it's 10 times the impact of the changing of consumption in China. So in standard economics papers, you'll just do a correlation. But if you look at it quantitatively, it's just tiny. Yeah.
Yeah. The warning of instability that you gave 4 days before this rise started, should that not have been issued a little bit earlier?
Yeah. Well, we knew about it earlier. The report was written earlier, but that's when we actually submitted it to the government. And the point here is that once we knew what the reasons were, once we did this analysis, the more important thing is not to just give the warning, but to prevent it. That's what I would much rather do. And in order to prevent it, we see what policies are in place that are causing the problem and can be reversed in order to solve the problem. So reversing the ethanol mandate, which is still being debated in Congress, there are bills in front of the US Congress that would repeal this. And reducing the speculation would be the things to do. Okay, because then it's not just about warning. Warning is not as good as stopping, right? So let me just say something about this. So here, I have a, where did the slide go? Somewhere else. Okay, this is a bubble. So this is prices that are out of equilibrium. So you know that if prices are out of equilibrium, supply and demand are not equal. So people are producing grain, but it is not being bought. So it's accumulating someplace. It turns out that these are futures markets, so it's accumulating later. You buy it now, but you get delivery 6 to 12 months later. So they accumulated an inventory, but 6 to 12 months later, if you look at the inventories, they showed up. Okay? So the point is that the grains exist and people are unable to buy them. Remember the riots and revolutions? The riots and revolutions were because people went to the shop and couldn't buy food. But the prices were high, not because there was no food, but because of the speculation, the financial speculation. So that's what I wanted to say about Ferrier Square. There's a long list, and it didn't show up here because the slides have been converted. But there's something that in the US they call the new normal of riots and revolutions around the world, and there's a long list of them. And what happened is that the food prices went up and down and up and down, and then they kind of stabilized at about the level of the threshold that we identified. And as a result, it's sort of not true that there are sort of revolutions all over all at once, but every now and then, any place where there's some irritation, a riot or revolution breaks out. Yes?
Sorry, I didn't want to interrupt, but could the current crude oil slump also be attributed to the corn ethanol conversion?
Give me just one second, I'll get to that. Yes, go ahead. You had another question?
Wondering whether, so it appears that the social economic environment where the crisis manifests as a riot is irrelevant.
It's not entirely irrelevant. The economic conditions of these countries and places where they didn't happen.
Yes.
The point is that it's not that we did an analysis of each country's conditions. That's not the message of this analysis.
Yes.
At this level, we're just saying that there are widespread conditions around the world that are consistent with riots and revolutions above this threshold.
If I may, the reason I ask is, the question is, how is it that some countries were able to, in a sense, contain the riot,
sure,
and others were not?
So that's a really important question, but the answer is in the question, right?
Yes. And
if government and policies responded to protect the population from desperation, right, why do people riot?
Because
they're desperate. They can't feed their families.
Suppose the self-learning comes.
So you have to know how to prevent it from happening when it's crisis. Yes.
Yes. What causes the speculation and by who?
Great. So the speculation, I think I have a slide to answer that. Do you have a question relevant to that? Or
I understand the tie-in with ethanol, but you said that there was tons of grain available.
Yes.
That it just wasn't being given. So ethanol production didn't eliminate the grains that were needed.
No, remember there are two different effects. Mm. There is the taking of the corn for ethanol.
And then there's
there's an addition over production beyond that supply and demand level.
What I'm saying is that there was enough grain to go around. It
correct.
Just wasn't being distributed.
Correct.
So it's not necessarily ethanol that doing it.
Well, but
it
depends when. Depends when and at what point in time, right? Because if we go back here, you see in 2007-8, look at this, in 2007-8, the impact of the ethanol was small compared to the impact of the speculation. But by the time we get to now, the impact of the ethanol is much larger. Okay, so it depends at what point in time you're talking about. Yeah. Let me try to answer the other question over here. So the question was about the speculation.
Yeah, kind of around quarter two, we'll
move
to something.
Okay. First of all, let me get to the energy issues. This is a plot of energy, oil prices. And we can do the same kind of modeling and show that there were peaks that are due to speculation. We've not continued it until now, but it is possible indeed that this current process is also speculative. It's not only positive, it can also be negative directions, and it's unstable. The market is unstable. The question about where this came from is here. This is the mortgage market crash. This is housing prices. This is the stock market crash. This is a peak you see of all commodities. What happened is that people needed some place to put money, so they moved it into the commodity markets. So this is not a supply and demand, it's a money movement issue. And as prices went up, right, it excelled, right, that's the trend following, right? Price go up, so people buy more, driving the price up even more, and that's how this bubble was created. Does that answer the question? Who was asked about this? Okay. So let me go on and talk about a couple of other things. This is analysis of the stock market dynamics. What we did here is we looked at panic on the stock market. So panic is when everyone is doing the same thing, right? If you get out of the market, I better get out of the market. So this is actually a measure of the degree to which people are doing the same thing. It's co-movement. The more co-movement is actually down and up is calm behavior, if you will. And what we did is we looked at the difference from 1 year to the previous year of this measure. And this is the measure of difference. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to mark the places where it went down by more than 2 standard deviations. So here the statistical measure is reasonable to use. And I marked the 1 year periods after it went down, after having been up above zero. Here are all the largest one-day crashes in the stock market. So what this says is that when you have a one-day crash, before that, people are panicky. That's not too surprising. People are panicky, and then you have a panic. But the point is that we can actually have a measure of panickiness and figure out when these crashes are going to take place. All right. Let me show you a couple of fun things that we can do. This is using Twitter. You're familiar with Twitter, yes?
Yeah.
So Twitter, a couple of percent of tweets are geotagged, so we know where the person was when they did the tweet. And what we did here is we did a sentiment analysis. So we asked how do people feel when they're tweeting. We didn't ask them, we just figured it out from the tweet. I don't know if you recognize this is Manhattan, right? And New York City. And if you look at this, if you know, this is Central Park. And the cyan is positive and the magenta is negative. So what we see is that people are happy in parks, which I'm sure surprises you a lot. They're unhappy in traffic jams going into tunnels and bridges. This is a sewage dump, which is stinks a lot. I have not been there, but I have it on good report. I haven't actually sought it out. So you can actually see how people feel using this kind of analysis. This is it's not going to show. I have a movie that I could show you some other time of how people, you know, wake up and go to work and go home and go to sleep, and you can see all the dynamics of Twitter behavior. And I have another one showing it globally, which again is not showing up. This is another analysis where we see how people organize themselves in society. So what we did is we took people who tweet links to New York Times articles, and we put this network together by pulling together the people who are talking to each other, connected, followers, and pushing apart the people who are not. And then we colorized this by the subjects that they were tweeting. And what we found out is that there are people who care about global things, and they talk to people who care about global things. There are people who care about New York, and they talk to people who care about New York. There are people who care about national things, and they're polarized into liberal and conservative, and people who care about business, sports, and arts. Now, the interesting thing about this is that this enables us to understand how society is organized, how it chooses, who chooses to talk to whom, which is really interesting, right? The last thing that I wanted to do, and this is just not going to work actually, so I think we're going to have to do it later, is I have, we did an analysis of Ebola. Let me see if I can, I'll just try to show it with this. This is, there's a video that I should be able to show you, but it's not, these things are not coming out right now. So let me try to explain what we did. So this is work we did about 10 years ago, starting more than 10 years ago. What we were interested in is the evolution of pathogens. So when pathogens mutate, viruses or bacteria, when they mutate, they can become more aggressive, spreading more rapidly or being more fatal, or they can mutate to be less. It turns out that in a spatial environment like this, this is a host is green and the colored ones are the pathogens. The ones that are the most aggressive ones don't thrive, they die out. Now, I'm not sure why it's clear, so because I can't show you the video, can anyone figure out why they would die out?
They're them.
No, because the host dies.
Because the host dies.
They are them. They kill their host.
They kill their host, exactly right. They kill their host and they die out as also, right? So here, if you look at it, there's a really aggressive variety. This is snapshots taken every 50 generations. So there is a bright blue one. You see that one? And it's rapidly spreading and it kills, it makes this hole in the space, right? And it dies out. And the ones that are less aggressive are the ones that you see later on. So that's really important to know. What happens if we add long-range transportation, i.e. airplane routes? So what happens is that we start with an image like this, where you have the ones that are less aggressive, let's say. And then as you add long-range transportation, you end up with more aggressive ones. Why? Because they escape the local extinction and get somewhere else. And as you add more long range, you get even more aggressive ones. And then you get an even more aggressive ones, but then the entire thing goes extinct. Is that clear? So we have this, what we call a phase transition to extinction, right? Phase transition is like water boiling or something. We have, for low connectivity in the system, we have a unit probability of survival. For high connectivity, we have a zero probability of survival, and there's this sharp transition between them. So as we add more and more transportation, we might go through this transition without even knowing that it happened. Okay. Now, I spoke about this January at the World Health Organization. They were a little bit surprised, so almost a year ago. Now, in addition to showing them this, I showed them a simulation, and again, all my simulations here are not working today because of the AV. I showed them a simulation which starts with a point infection where Ebola used to be. Now, I didn't do this because of the Ebola epidemic this year. I did this because Ebola is a terrible disease that was present in remote areas and was not spreading. And if you think about it for a minute, you'll realize that it's clear that once you have more transportation, it's going to escape. And we did. And in 2006, we wrote in a paper about this subject, watch out for Ebola. Because as transportation increases, we're going to end up with a global pandemic. So this is, of course, what happened. And I have to say that you would think that other people would be aware of this. But in general, people are always thinking about the experience that they already had and not thinking about what is going to happen as a result of changes or as a result of unlikely events that are eventually going to happen. So this is a real key issue, yeah.
Isn't that because of networks? Networks in healthcare often become specialized. But if you ask the transportation network, they'd tell you this is exactly what would happen.
Right. But this is a health problem, isn't it? We'll assign the doctors to be in charge of the response.
That's human network mobilization.
Right, so this is the way doctors treat patients, right? When the patient shows up in the doctor's office, we will figure out what's wrong and treat them. Is that the way to deal with an epidemic?
No.
No.
I think we will.
Yeah, we're almost done. I'm almost done. So we really need to understand this, and this is Freetown in Sierra Leone, and this is the explosion that's continuing to happen. It hasn't yet stopped there. What I want to do tomorrow more is I'll talk about the breakdown of this and what responses are really needed. And the real key thing, one of the key things is you need response that is not focused just on the individual. There has to be a community level response, there has to be a urban level response, there has to be a national response, there has to be a global response. But the physicians are not trained to do that. So we have to worry about that. Just as a story, I explained this, and I wrote a paper saying that we had to do a neighborhood level response. And we talked about sending in teams into neighborhoods and doing it. Then I called up people in Liberia, and they told me that, in fact, they just started doing this 2 weeks previously. And this is the infection rate in Liberia as it went up, and then as they started to implement the community level response, it went down. I can tell you that the physicians, a month and a half, even 2 months after this were happening, were saying, we don't understand why people are sick or not showing up at the hospital. They were sitting in the hospital waiting for the patients to show up, whereas the reason that it was being stopped is because people in neighborhoods were going around door to door and screening people for fever. So this was really quick, by the way, discussion of the riots and revolutions, the panic on markets, the issues that we saw on Twitter, which I just threw in there for the fun of it so we could see other things. There's Ebola, we could talk about terrorism, we could talk about other things. But the point is, we really have this global risk. There's a vulnerability globally because we're connected. Everybody's connected, wherever you are. And so we have to understand the nature of how these risks are propagating. And to understand that policy decisions, the ones that I talked about were the ones that were made in the United States, but today, policy decisions anywhere are affecting everywhere. Thank you.